Don't thank God for this day, this camera. Welcome, come on up to this cold dungeon instead of down to the dungeon. Okay. First of all, one thing about God works through. See, God works healing through faith. We talked about last week how Paul and his entourage ran. I say entourage, but his own ship. How they ran into trouble, life turned upside down for them. Dangerous sea, and they finally we think things are going great in life, on our way, you know, hits the fan. It's quite evident you're in a mess. What are we going to do? He found that they dumped on dry land. They ran aground. Come to find out that the guys who are operating the ship have actually, we thought it was an unpopular area last week, but it's quite popular port. This happened to be on the other side of it, a side that's not used very often to dock in. It's the port of Malta, or the place called Malta. I think that's close to Italy, somewhere like that. And so they just didn't know it at the time. We're going to find out today, so that how do you demonstrate faith in front of people that are different than you? And how do you maintain faith in very difficult situations when it seems as though life is, things are going good, but look, there's a bump in the road, upside down for a while. So how do you do that? Let's also remember that we have an advantage because we have a lot of scriptures on the New Testament written by this particular character we're studying, Paul, that helps us get our faith solid. A lot of things that he has written. I can do all things with Christ, all kinds of things like that. The word scripture. Let's remember, Paul had no scripture other than the one Old Testament. And we understand that all scripture is given, right? If you want to look that up, whatever it is, all scripture is given. So what was given is what he used to strengthen his life about faith in his Messiah. So our encouraging word today is that use scripture to build your faith. Faith come by how? Hearing the scriptures. By hearing the scriptures, the word of God. So, before we get started, let's find some protective scriptures that I have, as David says, hid in my heart, that I might not sin against him, or that I might not lose faith. But it can't be any New Testament scripture because we want to put ourselves where this guy is. Even if we had to go evangelize today, we left our books at home and our Jewish family was in our presence. I know y'all don't believe in the New Testament, Mr. and Mrs. Jewish family, so I have to come to you from another perspective. That would have to be from the Old Testament prophets. Got to find something in there that's going to get me where I want to go today. So, the most popular guy in the Old Testament is who?
David.
Abraham? Abraham and David probably be running neck and neck. But I would say the most popular guy definitely would be Abraham would be in it. But the most popular guy with a lot of achievements and taking us where we want to go would have to be David, Psalms as prophet and king. So let's see what David might have had to say about faith being fearless. I would go, if I were you, to Psalms, my favorite. Anybody know what that is?
No.
Psalms 27. Psalms 27. Some folks in Psalms 23. I say 27. And I can have you read that, and I can tell you if you're reading it right or wrong. If you miss the word. So, if I was to build myself on my most holy faith, and I didn't have any New Testament, I would go to Psalms 27. The Lord is my light and what?
My salvation.
What shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the what?
Strength of my life.
Whom shall I be afraid? All right. In and that is that when times are good, bad, upside down, that's all it happens. When shall I fear? I don't have any occasion to fear because I got someone got my back. Mm-hmm. Okay, when the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, come upon me to eat up my flesh, they do what? They stumble
and fall.
Though the hosts should encamp against me, my heart should not fear. Though war rise against me, even in this will I be what?
Confident.
One thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I might dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble, he's going to do what? And work.
In the secret
of his pavilion, of his tabernacle, should he hide me, he should set me upon a rock. And now shall my head be lifted up above my enemies round about me. Therefore I offer in his sacrifices, in his tabernacle, sacrifices of joy. Mm-hmm. I will sing, yea, I will sing praises unto the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I do what?
Cry.
Yes. Have mercy upon me and do what? Answer me. When thou saidest, seek my face, my heart said unto thee, thy face, Lord, will I seek. Hide not thy face far from me. Put not thy servant away in anger, for thou hast been my help. Leave me not, neither forsake me, O God of my salvation. And when my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will do what? Take me up. Teach me the way, O Lord. Lead me in a plain path because of my enemies. And my enemies are seen and unseen. Known and unknown. Deliver me not over into the world of those I just mentioned. For false witnesses are risen up against me, such as breed out cruelty. I have fainted. Unless I believe to see the goodness of the Lord were
in the land of the living.
Mother Earth. I don't have to wait till I get to the pie in the sky. I would have given up, caved out, what have you, if I have not believed to see, witness for myself, the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. What in the Lord? Wait means to what? Trust. Be of good courage, and he shall do what?
Strengthen
your faith to even grow more. You get stronger in faith, even if you learn to wait, learn to trust him. And I say, trust, wait, same thing as trust. Trust, I say, on the Lord. So, known and unknown stuff, I'm 60 years old. I think I have at least another 30 left around here. 60, 30.
Anyway,
hey,
how about,
let's make it 40.
Okay,
sure.
I
got 40 left at least. There's some known and unknown enemies of mine. The same, just like you have the same. So I have to find something to hold on to. Hold on to that scripture right there. Because the yogurt, when the yogurt, if the yogurt, how the yogurt, known and unknown, hit the fan. Okay, let's strengthen that a little bit further. Let's find another Old Testament from King David, Psalms 91, talking about life upside down. Life upside down. This is what Paul had before he had nothing else. But the word of the Lord, the promise of God, and that Damascus experience, but he had to have some scripture too. It says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High should abide in the shadow, under the shadow of the Lord.
Almighty.
I will say of the Lord, he is my word.
And
my fortress. My God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. Shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shall thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid of Sandy. Sandy is? Oh, that's that northeast thing. Katrina. Flu. Nor the arrow that flieth by high. Dang. Nor the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor the destruction that wasteth at what? Noonday. 1,000 should fall at thy side, 10,000 at thy right hand, but it should not come what? Not on Vancouver. Okay. Oh, okay. Only with thine eyes should thou behold and see the reward of the who? Of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, Thou shalt no none kind of way evil overtake thee, neither should any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee. Here we go, Brother McClellan, in the corner here.
Yes, sir.
To keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up. Someone finish out of the glory, please. Verse 12.
They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou shalt die thy foot against the stone.
Even an accident can't happen.
Thou shalt tread upon the lion and adder. The young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet.
My.
Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. He shall call upon me and I will answer him.
Yeah.
I will be with him in trouble.
When?
I will deliver him and honor him.
Yeah.
With long life will I satisfy him.
He shall be my salvation. What God has promised in both of these passages of Scripture is that in the time of trouble, in the time of trouble, trouble's not gone, it's known and unknown, seen and unseen. And when it raises its head against you or come against you, you have to take a stand that I'm in faith or I'm not out of faith. And these kind of scriptures right here kind of help keep us in faith because it's known and unknown. And they're called enemies. You know them or you don't know. There's some enemies that you watch out for every day. You just, check them out. And there's some enemies you don't know where they are, but they're lurking to blindside you. And what you know, we have to be assured of is this, that God's got my back. If I'm in trouble, if I find myself in trouble, God's got my back.
Amen.
Okay, so, this is the Apostle Paul, as he demonstrated last week. Now, these kind of scriptures, they're not just for us to have and absorb and to benefit from, but these kind of scriptures is what we have to demonstrate in front of other people. Mm-hmm. If we believe this, then we have to demonstrate it. Demonstrate it. That's why I get tickled when people say, William, stop talking about you never get sick, y'all, this, y'all. They'll even do that. Mm-hmm. I say, well, I got to do that because one day,
right.
there might be an occasion well, I have to demonstrate, not only as I have been demonstrating my faith, but I have to actually put it to work in front of somebody, and I've got to get some results right there. Right there. So we're going to see how Paul does this. Okay, Scripture, where we go? Well, over in the book of Acts, 28th chapter. God works healing through faith. Life takes a downturn. Where is God? I forgot to look at some scripture, though. It's in the book of James. And the prayer of faith. Y'all guys know what that is? The prayer of faith. I think it's in maybe the last chapter of the book of James. Maybe 5 and maybe 16. Maybe 15. I must be annoying today. I got it. Okay. James 5 and 15. Okay. Let's go to verse 13. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church. Let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. In verse 15, what does it say there? And the prayer of
faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up.
Yes.
And if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven.
And the prayer of faith, we want to see how God honors the prayer of faith. And the prayer of faith, God put it to work, the prayer of faith, okay. We've done that. Some of us knowing it and not knowing it. Okay, here we go. And then Romans 8:28. All things. Sometimes this is a hard lesson to preach. I teach. Romans 8:28. And we don't want to be confused that God makes bad things for his good stuff to work in. But if the scripture says, Romans 8:28, we know that all things work out together for the good to them that love God, to them which are the called according to his purpose. So we know that everything's going to work out to my benefit. To my benefit. That's what you have to say. No matter what's going on, the yoke against the fan or upside down, this is working. This is going to work for me to benefit by. Okay, all right. So, all right, now we're back to our lesson. Acts 28:1. Someone read that if you will, please. Boy, it is a little bit chilly up here. It's football weather. I need to be moving around. Chasing somebody down. Okay. Someone read that, if you will, please.
And when they were escaped, then they knew that the island was called
Malacca. That's a popular place now in these days. It is very popular. It's spelled today M-E-L-T-A. They leave out the I. But they knew that, so they recognized. Last week they didn't know where they were. Now they know where they are. Where they are. Okay. Interesting, verse 2, chapter 28. Someone read that, please.
And the barbarous people showed us no little kindness, for they kindled a fire and received us, everyone, because of the present rain and because of the cold.
Okay, we're in a bad situation. And what kind of people was it?
Barbarous.
Someone describe a barbarian to me. looking off Tulsa.
It's a matter
my
of
neighborhood. My neighborhood.
This is actually a good thing.
Okay. Barbarian. You say, you can't use this. You're a barbarian. You know what you mean? That you are uncouth, uncivilized.
Yeah.
Wow. You're the worst of the worst. Bottom of the pack. Bottom of the stack. This is the worst of, you know, but actually barbarians, that is actually, and we'll see it again later, it means, simply means people different than you. They behave and go through life different than you. And that has caused a lot of what we call prejudice, bias, all the way through our history. When we were taken out of Africa, people say, and the Native Americans, the Indians, they live different and, than the than the culture of Europeans. So therefore, the culture of Europeans called the five civilized tribes, the five tribes in Oklahoma, five civilized tribes because they have adopted to our culture, so they're not no longer barbarians, they're civilized tribes. And because they live like we, closer to what we do than anybody else. But a barbarian is somebody that lives and behaves and go about life a whole lot different than you do. Anybody ever met anybody like that? And I said, that's what I was this week. A bunch of excited. I said, don't. You said, I still have to be who I am. Yeah. You know, how do I level the playing field? Know who I am and know I guess I leveled it. I might have raised myself up a little bit. But barbarous people showed us what? No little kindness. In other words, they were very, very friendly. They're different, but they were friendly. Okay? For they kindled a fire. And that had to be a pretty big fire because it had to accommodate 276 people. Mm-hmm. So they had to blaze it up out there. Mm-hmm. Okay? Yeah. Because of the present rain, had to withstand getting wet, and because of the cold. And when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks, laid them on the fire, there came a viper. Why did that viper come out? Why did he come out? And bit Paul on the hand. Why did he come out? You ever heard of cause and effect? You do this and it causes that to happen. You do this, you got to do this, and you make that. That's going to happen because you do this.
Like, the came out, you know, at the emblem of Satan, and when Paul had told everyone that if they stay with the ship, where the soul be lost, and then they all made it to shore, you know, all of them made it there alive.
Yeah.
And so the viper, the devil comes up and says, no, I'm not going to do that. The viper.
Yeah.
Making it too hard.
Some people say, you know, the devil is the god of this world, so he's kind of manipulating everything anyway. But there's a cause and an effect. For example, I had to get me some new tires for my car this week, right? Now, if I had to keep driving around on those dogs, and I kept saying, man, I'm on the highway sometimes, I don't want to get on a slick street, or but I'm 75, 80, get to 85, I can get away with it. I'm screwed. You think something might pop?
Cause
and effect. Devil behind it? He don't mind Williams having a flat out there on highway nowhere in the middle of nowhere. He don't mind that happen, but it's cause and effect. So there's some things that wind up bad happening to us because we did not negate the cause of it happening. Whatever it may be. Some bad stuff is there, and how did it happen? Why did it happen? Maybe we didn't get in the way of the cause of it to happen. So, if you're going to be out in the middle of the jungle and you light a fire and then gathering up wood to the middle of the jungle, you can expect to run into a spider. If you're out there fishing, brother, you might see something every now and then. So that's what's cause and effect. And know whose fault is it? Nobody. I mean, you're just going through life, and you just do this, maybe something bad might happen. Do enough of the good stuff, some good stuff. So here it is. He does the viper that says, hey, y'all waking me up. What's up with y'all? Who's making this fire? So Hannah was doing it and did what to it? Bit it. That's what vipers, is that what that's what snakes do?
Yeah.
That's what they do. Man, I'll bite you. So, and when the barbarians, now we say we're calling them barbarians, saw the venomous beast hang on his hand, they said among themselves, no doubt this man is a what?
Murderer.
Whom though he had escaped the sea, vengeance suffered not to live. And this is where, if you're not in faith, the God kind of faith, you believe a cause and effect, you'll find any reason for a cause and effect. You got bad luck because you don't carry the rabbit's foot in the pocket. Anybody ever heard? Nobody heard that like that.
The child was born blind. Who sinned? The parent of the child.
Yeah, you break a mirror. I would do anything in the world to keep stay away from a broken mirror. I'm breaking the mirror. I got a mattress up under me. Everything else. Let that mirror fall. My life is like bad enough as it is. So that's
yeah, bad.
And I have my little Zodiac stuff all over the place. My jazz music and funny cigarettes, everything else. I was just really spacing about how to live life. Don't split a pole, walk on, step on a crack. Birthday dates and all this stuff. So if you're not in faith, and you get that stuff from where old, they call them old wives' tales, from grandma and grandma's grandma, and everybody else way, way back, they pass it down the line, and you find yourself believing it.
Yeah.
Go to a Chinese restaurant and read the fortune cookie. Before you even eat. and you don't know it. And guess what that affects? Your faith.
Your faith.
Psalms 91, Psalms 27. It's going out the window. And so when the yogurt hits the fan, you'll find a reason for the yogurt being in the fan. This is why it happens.
I wasn't praying enough. I wasn't fellowshipping enough. I wasn't giving enough. I'm just not saved enough. It's all kinds of stuff that comes into your head to explain why life is upside down. So, and that's nothing more than a what? Lack of faith. Woo! Someone bring the Quips and Degrees. Oh, no. We got to keep going. Okay. So, when the barbarian saw the actual beast hang on his hand, they said among themselves, no doubt this man is a murderer. He escaped the sea, yet vengeance is not going to allow him to live. Well, they don't know nothing about Paul. They just said this. Our superstitious belief lets us know this is a bad guy. He was so lucky to get out of that sea, that ocean, and say, now you got up here on dry land and they spend it. You just still gonna die. Our sister went. So superstitious beliefs and human nature will bring you to a conclusion that you don't want to be at. All right. Verse 25. And he shook off the beast. Verse 5. He shook off the beast into the fire and felt no harm. Mm-hmm. Now, here's the key right here. When that life turns upside down, you got it going. Oh, I'm on an upside down track all of a sudden. That's what you got to do. Shake it off. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I got bit. Yep, he's hanging on. Shake it off. Oh, yeah, wow. You know, a neck upside down situation, event, then, yeah, you're there, then just shake it off. Don't shake your faith off, but just say, okay, you know, wow. Cause and effect, wow. I cuss my boss off, I'm going to get fired. Cause and effect, shake it off. Shake it off. Going down the road. All right, so here we go. How be it to read verse 6, if you will, please.
Howbeit they looked to when he should have swollen or fallen down dead suddenly. But after they had looked a great while and saw no harm come to him, they changed their minds and said that he was a god.
He was a god. See, it's amazing, but demonstrate faith.
They check it and watch to see what
he was. Yeah, this guy's supposed to be falling over. And what they saw was amazing demonstration of faith makes you appear that you are really walking close to God. Yeah. And you shake it off, not only for you, but for the crowd, the neighborhood, the co-workers, and everybody else who's watching you go through your mess, your upside down bits in life. Mm-hmm. Watch and see how you're going to handle it. And we're not talking about any lightweight stuff. We're talking about some major happenings in your life that is evident you're going through, and all eyes are on you to see how you deal with it. Mm-hmm. And if you demonstrate, if you're walking in the Word and walking in faith, they're going to say, man, close to being like God. That's how God related to that. Mm-hmm. And he shook off a portion of steak like he was a God. He shook it off. Mm-hmm. And you know, your walk of faith, your demonstration of faith, believe it or not, is building faith in others who are watching you. Okay, so
you think during that time that when they really think he was God, that as the Bible bid him, you know, in most cases, if you pick up and you see a Bible hanging around, you get excited, you're nervous, and you know, go ranting and raving. He just shook him off like nothing happened and made them think that he was more than just a man.
Let's be honest with ourselves today. Mass embarrass ourselves. Let's see, brother. Liven up one of these. It's a little bit cold in here, so these rascals are dormant.
Yeah.
Maybe not necessarily dead.
Liven one of these.
Y'all see these little bugs? If it got to be 70 degrees in here all of a sudden, them papers is going to be flying around.
How many of us would say, I got to get out of here? And maybe turn down the door and mow over Brother John's camera. Yeah. We run across a snake, a grasshopper. Somebody I know just cannot live in the same world as a grasshopper. Grasshopper.
That's why we need jumps. I don't like it.
Lord, life is upside down. Lord, I'll give you all the money you want. Get that grasshopper out of here. You know, I myself don't jump, move nothing myself. I think that also helps me.
Walter don't do me, but I
think that conditions me for other stuff in life. I just don't jump. Mice, a rat, cat, big dog, what have you. It doesn't send me,
In the military, you know you better know.
Yeah, I mean, hey, you're in the military, what you gonna do? You're jumping all the way. So I think if a person can give himself condition for the stuff like that, like I just mentioned, when the other stuff comes up in life, you kind of, I got it. Now, that might be the way, I don't know, but that's how I am, it doesn't bother me. Some people see a drunk walking down the street, wobbling down the street, they just go to the other way, in the grocery store, what have you, they don't mind. Just the way this is a drunk guy, it doesn't bother me. So, but we have to, and that's all because of what superstition. Superstition, the unknown belief system that's passed down can register in you, and if you don't shake yourself from that, it's going to mess with your faith in believing Psalms 27, Psalms 91, and anything else. Matthew 11, what's that? I mean, Mark 11 and 23, mess with all that. So we have to be on guard. That's what we have to be on guard for. All right. So, still in faith. Acts 28 and 8, before we get to verse 7, let's see if that's worth reading. Acts 28 and 8.
Yeah.
Is that right? Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, it is. How about that? Let's go ahead and read verse 7. In the same quarters were possessions of the chief man of the island, whose name was Phileas, who received us and lodged. Publius. Who received us and lodged us 3 days courteously. So the head of the island, the mayor, the chief, whoever he might be, of these weird people that's not like us. But we can't use our prejudice and say that they're subhuman. They just live different than we do. So they even have they have some type of organization or system. He's the head of it. He's the chief. And it came to pass that the father of this guy just happened to be what?
Sick.
Mm-hmm. We are going through our stuff, our problems, and there is a need nearby. And if we are jumping around in fear of every little event that comes up that tries to intimidate us, I mean, I really don't have this is Brother Williams right here now, y'all. This is really school of theology. When I see people scared of stuff, they probably won't be the one that I call to say, come lay hands on me. I saw that sister run from a butterfly the other day. I don't think so. Let me see. I'm trying to find somebody to agree with me, touch and agree with me. back in the day when I first got saved, I didn't have a lot of people to go to
what a belief system. Mm-hmm. They all have some type of baggage that they're hanging on to. Even my grandmother's, you know, they said, "Oh, child, if you do this, take this and do that, and this castor oil and pour it down the child's all or whatever this crane concoctions and you know." I said, "Hey, that don't kill them, he out of here. We don't put them." I just don't. And then when people that live in fear and say this happened, this catastrophe happened because the Lord brought it on and all of them. Man, I gotta find somebody to touch and agree with because you know the tornado came through because God was mad at them folks over there in that community. Oh wow! So you have to watch and be very concerned about who you're asking to come into your prayer circle to help make a difference. Now here's this Apostle Paul. As you live life long enough, you're going to run into situations where someone's going to call on you and say, "Hey, bring out your faith. Bring it on out right now. We need your faith. And we're looking for, let's put it out right here. Put it on the line. What do you believe?" So here's the Apostle Paul. And I don't, he's surrounded by people that's watching him, but most of them, who could he get to say, "Hey, come pray with me for this guy's father"? Was there anybody? No, not this guy. Nobody he could get to agree with him. Who's left? Just you. So sometimes it's just going to be just you believe. Now what? Just me. To whom Paul entered in and did what? Prayed and laid his hands on him and healed him. Now here's who I am, surrounded with a bunch of unbelievers. First of all, I have to demonstrate that there is a God. That I have an invisible God. Okay? Now, how are you going to do that? Like he did before when he told them, take up some food and eat. Instead of just grabbing the food and eating, he did what? He prayed to his God. And I believe it was Peter who raised up some young person from the dead. And the Bible says that before he went in, Peter prayed. And then he went in and laid hands. Now, so you have to demonstrate that I have faith in, this is not me, it's God. Let me pray to God. Let me call on the Lord. And before I even call myself laying hands, ministering, counseling, or what have you, let me go into prayer because I got to have God. Mm-hmm. And so that's what Paul demonstrated was that he prayed. How long was he in prayer? I don't know. But it was long enough for everybody to know that he's praying. Mm-hmm. Then he went and laid hands. Mm-hmm. So he and prayed and laid his hands on him and healed him. So now we got a demonstration of faith in unfavorable events. And it's not for Paul, but it's for somebody else. And so this man's in a mess, and he's still getting good stuff to happen to somebody else. Wow. Wow, his life's been on the line, almost killed and everything else. Life's upside down for him, but he's still able to use his faith to help somebody else. That's when you know.
Dr. Williams, yes. Do you subscribe to the fact that that may have, that cause and effect is some kind of test, usually of faith?
With believers, nothing happens accidentally. You just he's having been in the wrong place at the wrong time. I don't think that ever with believers. I think believers are there to make an effect. No, it's a bad deal here, but guess what? It's going to change for our benefit.
It's how you react.
That's
how,
yeah.
As to how people around you.
That's right, yeah. It's a bad deal here, but guess what? It's going to come out. That's what Romans 8, 28 says.
What Jesus said about Lazarus' death.
Yeah.
So that God can be glorified.
Yeah, it's a bad deal here, but God will get some glory.
God will get some glory.
It's a bad deal. It's not God's plan. It's not God's idea for this guy to be like this. Or this situation is a circumstance. But guess what? It's going to come out. We're going to turn it. It's going to turn around.
That calls for the first
all things happen for the good.
Yeah, for those that love God, that are the call. So when this was done, others also, which had what? Diseases in the island came and were healed. Now, but here's the deal. They came to Paul. Now, the type of sickness that that father had is something that is an intestinal deal that causes bleeding and just type of bad digestive pain situations. And it's called Maltod disease because when you eat unsanitary clean food and it's not processed the way it's supposed to be, you're subject to get sick. Now, all you got to do is live in a foreign country. Ain't that right, Brother McClellan?
Yes,
everybody has been in the military. It don't take long. People have some of that.
That's the wrong word.
You think sitting is your permanent position for a while. They got you. And so here we call it. It's a common deal. I mean, but everybody's suffering from it. Can I get well from this? Can I get delivered from this? And they said, Paul, the man, the chief has been taking care of you, putting you up, giving you great hospitality. His dad is sick. Let me go see him. Where is he? Pray for him. And then they said, man, that kind of sickness right there, that stuff right there, you just don't get well from that. How did that happen?
Not only that, but it's contagious.
Yeah, it's contagious now. It's Brother William's School of Theology again. Flu season, NyQuil, NyQuil, NyQuil for sale, tablets for sale. Stop at the store, get your flu shot, flu epidemic, and all kinds of stuff is advertising. Give them something so you don't get that stuff. And then that's William's School of Theology. Oh, man, please.
Don't take
the flu shot. Please. Yeah, what are we going to do? Not only that, but there's all type of commercials on TV for to get something to keep you from getting what? Sick. It's all type of stuff. And then they give you the side effects.
Yeah.
I warn you on the side effects.
If you take this, y'all,
If you're a woman with pregnancy, don't take that. I mean, if you think you're pregnant, almost pregnant, I said, well, how about just getting some faith?
Yeah.
and once they saw Paul pray and then laid hands, say pray and then lay hands. Hands, laying on of hands is a doctrine, it's a teaching that's valid throughout all ages. It is a transfer of what one person has to another person if they got the same kind of faith, if their faith would match up. So, and I don't know what Paul did to get this guy in faith. Maybe it was his prayer. Or maybe it was just the gift of laying on of hands, the gifts of healing. The gift, I think Paul operated in the gift of healing. So sometimes it's just the gift of it.
Could it just been that he heard how he shook that snake off?
Yeah. So faith come by what? Hearing. So if I, if I got you in agreement, man, you want me? I'll pray for you. Do you want me to lay hands on you? Do you agree? Let's lay hands. So that's what the Bible says in James. Let the elders do what? Lay hands.
Lay hands.
Lay hands. Now anybody is authorized to lay hands. Mark 16 and 16. They should lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. And if you're an assembly of believers, you certainly should have some elders in there that can do lay hands. You don't have to call Sister Molly from the back of the church or the children's church to come up here and lay hands on somebody. There should be somebody in that assembly that can just do the practice of laying hands.
And I also found out, too, that the saying in the Bible is true. If you're sick with some kind of disease or anything that happens from sin, if you go to the elder, the church, and they pray for you, you will be healed. I had that experience. I was sick from something, and it was a big scare. And I went to this older lady. It was just one lady, and she prayed and agreed with me. And she said, now, when you go back, your test going to be all right. I found that to be true.
And so you can get a lot of other faith systems that'll take you off into the superstitions and everything. Go get your edifice, or go wear some brass around your wrist. get you some Kool-Aid and stuff, drink it with olive oil and all this and all that. And so how about just believe God? There's all kinds of things that'll get you off into the superstitions and away from faith. It'll just a little bit of a variance and you're out of faith. Oh man, so got to be careful. And he healed him, and when this was done, others also which had diseases in the island came and were healed. This is a strange place. You know, we're living out here like wild folk, like wild hogs, but they got enough sense to realize that, hey, there's something about this guy. He's demonstrating faith. He's shown faith. There's something. So when we all got up there sick with our superstitious stuff, ain't none of it working, let's go to somebody that's got some faith and get what? Healed. And that's what they did. They got healed. Who also honored us with what?
Many honors.
Now, this is how God has designed for his ministers to live. When they minister and do a good work in the name of the Lord and get results. Now, I'm going to ask you this. How much did Paul and them lose on that ship?
Everything.
But when they started walking and demonstrating faith, how much was returned to them?
Everything
and more. From the collectiveness of all the people that they had ministered, they brought gifts to them. Because they got to get back up. Guess what? On the ship to go where? They still got to go to Rome.
And then they
don't
ship out there now.
So we still got to hit the water again when traveling is good, but we don't have any resources. And so people did what? They ministered to the preacher's need. Oh, that ain't scripture. Yes, it is. I don't know what with your what? Substance. And the first fruits of what?
All that increase.
Now, honor the Lord with your substance. That's what these, this island, are they believers now or are they still pagans?
They believe us now.
You wonder if Paul didn't teach him? Think he did, went on the evangelist circuit around there and preached the folks? Yeah, because what? It's a good, it's to my what? Benefit. Paul was ministering and he benefited out of it. Boom. I don't know how much he got, but it says, honor us with what? Many honors. Who also honored us with many honors, and when we departed, they did what? With such things as were what?
Necessary.
That's why I'm going to have a need for nothing. Hallelujah.